to my knees, will I fall, will I sing hallelujah, will I be able to speak at all, I can only imagine, yeah, I can only imagine, surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel, will I dance for you Jesus, or in all of you be still, will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall, will I sing I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the we
time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
We're gonna start in about 5 minutes. We're just waiting for a few people, okay?
Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Jesus, I will worship your holy name. Worship your
yeah. sadness has found me. I'd do anything for more time. Never before has someone meant more, and I can't get you out of my mind. There's so much that I don't understand, but I know you're dancing with the angels. Son, your heart will be heard in your unspoken words through generations to come. There's so much that I don't understand, but I know you're dancing with the angels.
First Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 says, "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as do the rest who have no hope." On behalf of your extended family and friends and church families that are represented here, we want to express our deepest condolences. Where's Brooke and Britt? There they are. Okay. To all of you guys, Mark and Anthony and Josh and Brooke and Britt and John and Elsa, especially, all of you. Lisa was an amazing woman. We know that she is face to face with the Lord. I'm going to say a few things before we pray. We know that she's freed from this body of flesh. She's freed from the suffering. And we know that this dear family, every one of you, will see her again in glory. As this passage says, we do not sorrow as those who have no hope. And we have this incredible confidence that this is not the end, that God's plan for Lisa is actually just beginning. But Job's three friends, they came and they sat down with Job, and they were silent for a week. It says, because of his great pain. And he had lost his whole family. Jesus himself, at the grave of Lazarus, wept. And Jesus knew exactly where Lazarus was and what he was going to do, and that he would raise Lazarus again. And he still wept. a clear understanding, a biblical understanding of where Lisa is, does not take away the pain and the grief of the loss. Paul says we just don't grieve in hopelessness like the world does, because they're never going to see their loved ones again. We know and we have this confident expectation that we will, but that doesn't take away the loss. This is a grievous bereavement, not just because Lisa was taken, but that she was taken in the prime of her life. Dreams were broken, and this loss from our vantage point seems, unredeemable. So if you have doubts and questions and frustrations and maybe anger and fear and all of that, you are absolutely normal. Mary and Martha both, two different times, but at the same time, they both came to Jesus and practically speaking rebuked him, saying, quote, "If you had been here, our brother wouldn't have died." Basically saying, you could have done something about this and you didn't do it. And we know that the Father is omnipotent. He's all-powerful. He spoke the universe into existence, and he certainly could have changed the outcome of Lisa's disease. But he didn't. So please know, as a family, we will continue to pray for you and support you. But none of us can even imagine or enter into what has happened in your life, what you're going through. But we want you to know, and everybody here certainly wants you to know, that we care for you deeply, and we're praying for you, and we will be here for you as you have been here for us in so many different times and circumstances. So let's take this to the Lord in prayer, and I'd ask you to pray with me, and I'm going to commit this time to the Lord. This is going to be about another hour from now, so if in the meantime you have to use the restroom or something, that's fine. It's not a problem. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this dear, beautiful family that have their lives centered on the Lord Jesus Christ. And when things happen to good people that we can't explain or understand, we have to come back to who you are, and you are good all the time. And you are love. And you're omniscient, and you have all the facts. You know everything. And while our ways are not your ways, and your ways are not our ways, we don't always understand what's going on, but we do trust in you. We pray that the things that are said and done this afternoon would honor the Lord Jesus Christ and would honor this dear, beautiful woman, Lisa, and would encourage this family and strengthen them, not only in their confident hope that they will see her again, but in their bereavement and in the grief of this loss. And we thank you. It's a privilege for us to be here, to be able to bear this burden with them and be able to try to be an encouragement to them. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Is Sean? Where is Sean? Sean, come on. And let me get that. There you go. Okay.
Proverbs 31, 25 through 31. She's strong and respected and not afraid of the future. She speaks with a gentle wisdom. She's always busy and looks after her family's needs. Her children show their appreciation, and her husband praises her. He says, "Many women are good wives, but you're the best of them all. Charm is deceptive and beauty disappears, but a woman..." "A woman who honors the Lord should be praised. Give her credit for all she does. She deserves the respect of everyone." Deuteronomy 10:12. "What does the Lord your God require of you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul?"
All right, please stand and sing with us.
Great is our God.
how great is our God. How great is our God. How great, how great is our God. How great is our God. How great is our God. How great, how great is our God. All right, you may be seated.
Let's pray. Father, we think about how great you are and how you literally spoke the world into existence and the universe just by the word of your power. And yet you took the time to knit each one of us together in our mother's womb in your image, in your likeness. And this woman was a beautiful project of yours. And we all experienced the blessing and the grace and the kindness and the smiles and the lightheartedness, the twinkle in her eye and the compassion and the servitude and the humility, the genuine love. And we celebrate that. We love you, Father, for who you are. We praise you and we honor you because you are great. You are glorious. And it's only because of the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ shed on our behalf for our sins that we can sing and praise our Heavenly Father at a time such as this. And we do truly praise you for who you are, and we trust you in this. In Jesus' name, amen. We would like to give you an opportunity to share short and succinctly anything that you'd like to share, and you can stand where you are and share something about Lisa that you appreciate, and then after several, we'll try to get you a microphone, but after several, we'll close it out in about 10 minutes or so. And so, okay, anybody would like to share? The first one's always the hardest. Okay, Lewis?
I don't think
Lewis, use the microphone. I know.
No, I'm good.
Okay, all right.
My name is Suzette, and I'm one of her cousins. She was always the cousin that that I wanted to grow up to be like. She was my older cousin, And she was someone I could definitely look up to and admire. When I was 8 years old, she brought this guy into the family named Mark. But when she did that, she gave all of us girls something that we could look up to and say, that's how I need to be treated by a young man one day. And then 2 years later, when I was 10, she married this guy named Mark. And she taught us that fairy tales can come true and that you can find someone who loves the Lord and will treat you well throughout your marriage. And because of that, I think some of us girls were able to find exactly what she had because she set that example for all of us. In motherhood, she shined. That's where she really just, she was beautiful. When she passed, I told my kids, it's because of Lisa that we do all of these things during the summer, because I watched her do all of these things with her kids during the summers. Take them to the beach. Even little things like the library were a huge deal. But she taught me how to do those things with my kids. She was also excellent at saving money and coupons. I was getting Publix baby clubs when I was living in New York because she would ask, hey, can you sign up for the Publix baby club? I was in high school. And she needed the extra coupons so that she could get all of these freebies for Anthony and for Joshua. So once I had kids, I knew all about the Publix Baby Club. She homeschooled her kids, and she did an amazing job with that. She was able, as every mother who homeschools, we want to be able to make it to the end. She made it to the end with all four, and that is something that we homeschool moms strive to achieve. I also learned from her that if you're going to put your child in a children's program, you teach the class. So if you're going to put your kid in VBS, you teach their class. And I have taught my kids classes in VBS every year. If you're going to put your kids in Sunday school, you teach their class. Because she did that, and I just learned that from her. But then I also learned prayer, because she would always go into her prayer closet. When there was a problem, she would tell me about her prayer closet. And she would go into that prayer closet, and she'd come out, and she'd be fine. But she would always take everything to the Lord. And then her final example to us was during her battle with cancer, where we didn't see her fall apart, and she may have, but she didn't show that to us. Instead, she was found praising during the times of her deepest pain. And what an example for us that is how we are supposed to face adversity, regardless of how it comes to us. We need to face adversity the way Lisa did. So she was just an awesome cousin, beautiful mother, and I'm proud to have been her younger cousin.
Hi, everyone. I'm one of Lisa's cousins, and I'm Suzette's sister as well. And so I wanted to write some things down, so I'm going to be reading just so I didn't forget anything. But I put, Lisa was such a beautiful and fun person. Some people just have that thing about them that makes them stand out and draws people to them, where you just want to be around them, and that was Lisa. She was fun and had fun little phrases and mannerisms that just made her so special and fun to be around. Some cute things I remember about Lisa were her saying, oh, stop, and oh, yeah. And she also knew how to laugh, just like my sister. You don't want to be around them if something embarrassing happens. And at a church dinner that we all attended, when a woman tripped and the chicken on her plate went flying, you can only imagine Lisa's laughter and how the laughter continued long after the occurrence and during later retellings of the story. Lisa had a high-pitched baby talk for the little ones in our family, especially with Addie and other little ones, creating her own loving language. And I can specifically hear her saying, Nini, to babies in our family. And I ended up nicknaming Elena, one of our cousins, Nee, and I wonder if in some way that was influenced by her. I can also remember her calling Anthony Twinnis. That was one of her nicknames for Anthony. And perhaps in doing so, she prophetically birthed Brooke and Britt. Lisa was also a wonderful wife and mother, and together she and Mark, like Suzette said, were the ideal cool couple that we both looked up to as younger cousins. Lisa loved her family well and invested her life loving and caring for and protecting her family as best as she knew how. And God and her family were her world. I personally know what it's like to lose a mom like that. Someone who, you know, really invested themselves in you and who was your best friend. That was my mom as well, and I lost her as well. Wives and moms like that are a rare treasure, and Lisa will definitely be missed. So just love you all.
Got some nervous laughter over here. I didn't know Lisa, but I knew their parents. My name is Victoria, and John and Elsa are just such loving people, and in this time where I knew they were grieving, the Lord had given this to me, and I gave it to them, and I asked for their permission to share it. And it is a poem that I wrote for them. Grief indescribable, words untold, a formidable journey now unfolds. No words can give script to what this ache has become. I will look to the hills where God's help comes from. Losing a child cannot be understood. I need cleave to the Savior, for I know he is good. Do I grieve? Do I wonder why troubles befall? Surely I do, and my Lord knows it all. My wonders, my questions for now may remain till I walk unto glory, no more sorrow, no more pain. Separated for now, while I wait in this place, my walk shall testify of God's abundant grace. And that was just what else his character reminded me of, and I just believe with all my heart that this woman, Lisa, is a product of two godly, amazing parents.
I just remember Lisa always carried the joy of the Lord with her. She was such a joyful person. And for a period of time, she did the children's class on a Wednesday night. And it was my youngest, Annie's most favorite class that she ever did. She loved it. And Lisa was so talented in that way. And my youngest and the twins were born a week apart. We were both struggling to have more children, and the Lord blessed us. And remember the light of the Lord that she brought with her. Thank you.
My name is Jacob. I am one of Lisa's many, many unofficially adopted children, as well as my wife Zoe and the rest of my family, especially my little sister Laura. And there's just two things I wanted to say about Lisa. Number one, she thought I was the funniest person in the world. And every time I left her presence, I would leave with the bruises to tell about it. everyone that knows her well knows exactly what I'm talking about there. And the second thing I want to say is she was probably one of the most loving people I've ever met in my life. Me and my family did not deserve the love that lady showed to us. She was just incredible in the way that she loved me and my family and prayed for me and my family. And those are two things that I'm always going to strive for, is to be able to love like she did and be able to pray for people the way that she did. It was absolutely amazing. And I feel like I'm supposed to speak over Brooke and Britt, that they're going to carry a new level of love than what Lisa did, that she's going to pass on a greater amount of love that Brooke and Britt are going to be able to show to people to a whole new level than what Lisa did. And so I just want to say how much to the family that we love and appreciate Lisa and the love that she showed to people and the way that she prayed for people.
Is there anyone else? Okay. Thank you for that, all of you. That was perfect. Sean? Mary?
Psalm 91. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For it is he who delivers you from the snare of the trapper and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you may seek refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and a bulwark. You will not be afraid of the terror by night or of the arrow that flies by day, of the pestilence that stalks in darkness, or of the destruction that lays waste at noon. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not approach you. You will only look on with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked. For you have made the Lord, my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. No evil will befall you, nor will any plague come near your tent, for he will give his angels charge concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will bear up their hands lest you strike your foot against a stone. You will tread upon the lion and cobra, the young lion and serpent you will trample down. Because he has loved me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him securely on high, because he has known my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. With a long life I will satisfy him, and let him behold my salvation. Psalm 112, verse 4 says, light arises in the darkness for the upright. He is gracious and compassionate and righteous. This family knows God. There's a generational and a wonderfully godly heritage
in this family, both the immediate family and the extended family. And but this loss and the grief that you all bear will at times and for years to come, it will bring you back to a very lonely place and a very dark place. And I say that in the sense that there's no one else that can truly enter in to what's going on in your souls. And truly, and I appreciate the reading of Psalm 91, there's no other place to work through that those times when you have just waves of grief other than the presence of God. In an enduring trial, and I say this, and this is an enduring trial because you're experiencing it for a long time until you die. When people lose loved ones when they're older, it's very different than it is now. But in an enduring trial like this, we need the person of God. We need the grace and the compassion. We need the truth, the righteousness of God, all mixed together with his personal love. And that's all found in the presence of God, not found necessarily in a church service or listening to the radio. It's found in the very presence of God. Lisa had a habit of spending time in the presence of God. She had it, and as Suzette said, when she came out, everything was fine. Didn't matter what the trial was, but everything was fine as far as her soul and the Lord is concerned. She put it in the right hands. We need to know that God is good in the midst of the furnace or out in the wilderness or when we're all alone in a dark room and the curtains are drawn because we really don't want anybody else in there. It's just you and the Lord. His Holy Spirit dwells in you, and his jealous love is there, and it's all around you. No matter if things get better or worse, because they will get better and they will get worse. If they get hotter or colder, or longer, or shorter, or lonelier. God is our good Father, and he never changes. And as the psalm said, he alone is our refuge and our strength. He alone is the good shepherd. You've not experienced that and had intimacy with God, it's not because you haven't had trials. It's because you haven't taken those trials and those burdens into the presence of the Lord. There is, in Psalm 91 and in so many other places in the Scripture, a cherished place of the Lord, even in this kind of a trial, and maybe especially in this type of a trial. And you can call it a lion's den, you can call it a dungeon or wilderness. But this is where God makes a man, and this is where God makes a woman. It's where his character, his person, is indelibly marked into your life. His essence is melded into you. And he pours out his love into a broken heart. I'm going to read a passage from Romans. Very important passage. It says, not only this, we also exult in our tribulations, knowing that tribulation brings about perseverance, and perseverance proving character, and proving character hope. And hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts. This is where God pours his love into a broken heart. You may have experienced that already at times, and you may feel like you're never going to experience that again, but you will. you will. That heritage has been passed down to you. God is very jealous over this family. Second Timothy chapter 1, Paul tells Timothy, he goes, I'm mindful of the sincere faith within you. I'd say your wife's faith was sincere. I'm mindful of the sincere faith within you, which first dwelt in your grandmother, Adelaida, Lois, and your mother, Eunice, Elsa, as I'm sure that it is in you as well. And this love, this faith, was in Lisa. She lived out her faith. Her glory was the Lord. Her glory was her husband and her children. She didn't need the glory from anything else. She didn't need glory from a house or riches or a job or anything else. She had all the glory that she needed. And I would that women of this world, real women, would understand that. She was committed to what God gave her. And she was content with that, happy with that. And Mark, God gave you an amazing wife in Lisa. As I said, her whole life, and has been said already, revolved around you and her children, your children. Most all of you know she arranged their whole schedule. Everything was arranged around Mark's work. And I always valued that. I always thought that was amazing. They would have meals at weird, really weird times of the night, and so that the family could be having dinner together at what, 3 a.m? I don't know. It wasn't that bad, but it was different. It was definitely different. And Brooke and Britt, Josh, and Anthony, God gave you the best mother you could have. And now she's with him, with the Lord. And from our vantage point, it is way too early. And you need to just kind of get that out on the table. God is good, but from our vantage point, it's too early. And everyone else's life will go on, including every single person in this room, except yours and yours. And you're not going to be able to avoid it or get out of that. There'll be days where you feel locked in a prison of grief and very perplexed as to why God would allow this or do this. And there's no one else around that will be able to help or console your soul. And that's real dark. But he's in that place. That's under the shelter of his wings, like the psalm said. He's there. He was there waiting for you. And y'all are young. But as Jacob said, or one of y'all, Faye maybe, I don't know. Pure gold gets refined over and over again. And often and for a long time. And so you'll live with this. It will refine your faith. It will make you into amazing wives and mothers and a husband. Josh is about to get married. And we all envy the families that you will produce. Mark, they will give you tremendous joy and blessing. And our hearts ache that you won't be able to share it with Lisa. But God is purifying this sincere faith that was passed on to your mother and received from your ancestors. He's forming his person in you, more than most. John and Elsa, you survived both your only son and your only daughter. And there are very few people on the earth that will ever be led to that place. Very dark, very lonely. We've watched you bear this over the last many years at John's loss. And what you have confirmed in our hearts and our minds, and I'm sure the rest of this family's lives, that God's grace is truly sufficient for your time of weakness, and that there is no other place. We know that there will be times in all of your lives where you fail and you fall apart. You may even lose faith, but he is right there. God has real big shoulders. He's had people yell at him before. He's all good with that. He's going to be there to hold you. And so we are very sorry for you, and we mourn for you. John and Elsa, especially, we envy your faith. We envy the love that you have in your heart for your Lord. We envy the strong marriage that you have and the fierce love and loyalty that you have in your family that we have witnessed in your extended family. We all want your faith. We all want what your family has. But there's not a person in this room that wants to endure what you've endured to get there. None of us would walk down this road willingly. You would never have walked down this road willingly. Our Father did. And he saw fit for you too. Our God is good. You've experienced him as your Savior. And now you're experiencing him as your Redeemer and your Comforter and your Shepherd, your Guardian, your Counselor, your Healer. So I would encourage you, when you're in that dark place, to go ahead and pull the blinds shut. Allow yourself to be there with him alone. He is faithful. He is everything that you need. And we can only say this by faith, believing what the Word of God says. We don't say it by experience or that we know this because we've not been there. And he is going to be holding fast to your heart with his jealous and patient and enduring love. I want to read a couple passages, starting in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And this gives us perspective because God's word is eternal and written in the heavens. It is absolutely true. There's nothing else more true. You can't get more truth or less truth. It's either true or it's not. And this is absolutely God's truth on what happens with this body in relation to eternal things. What happens to the body and the person of the individual that places their faith in Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5, it says, we know that if this earthly tent, which is our house, talking about the body, is torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For indeed in this house we groan. And have y'all groaned before in this body? And indeed this house we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven. Inasmuch as we having put that dwelling on, we will not be found naked. For indeed, while we are in this tent, we groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but clothed, in order that what is mortal may be swallowed up by what is life. And he who prepared us for this very purpose, that means that our mortal life being swallowed up by life, he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave to us the Spirit as a pledge. He put his Holy Spirit in us and sealed us into the day of redemption. It's like putting a down payment on a car. So that's mine right there. Because that person placed his or her faith in Jesus Christ. They're mine, purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ. And I will redeem their body. Therefore, being always of good courage, and knowing that while we are at home in this body, we are absent from the Lord. My mother just passed away, and it's nothing compared to this. But the last time we took her to the hospital, she looked at me, and she had a little bit of dementia going on, and she said, "Why are you bringing me here? Why am I in the hospital? I do not want to be here. I want to die." That's what she said. "I want to die." And I wanted to say, "Mom, that's perfectly biblical, but we've got to do what we have to do." We have good courage, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. Y'all, we are absent from the Lord. And to the extent that your life is going good, you want to stay absent from the Lord. And to the extent that your life is going downhill, and especially maybe in the last throes of death, you want to be with the Lord. There's a lot of older folks in this room that would rather be with the Lord. Raise your hand if you'd rather be with the Lord. Some of y'all are having some aches and some pains. That's right. It says, "For we walk by faith," meaning we live by faith, meaning what we can see in the spirit realm. We can't see it in the physical realm. We live by faith, not by sight. And then it says, "And we are of good courage," and say, "We are of good courage," I say, Paul says, "and prefer rather to be absent from the body and to be home with the Lord. Therefore, we have it as our ambition, whether at home or absent, to be pleasing to the Lord." And I remember sitting and talking to Lisa before she was going into surgery and knowing, okay, her ambition in this whole process, her ambition was not just to live. She wanted to live. She was trusting God to live, okay? But her ambition was faithfulness. She wanted to be faithful to the Lord Jesus Christ through the suffering. And when she was crying out, Allison, Elsa, you all experienced this, you saw this. In the deepest pain, she was crying out to the Lord. And that wasn't fake or put on, it was real. Because what's in the furnace, when the fire gets really hot, what comes out is what's in there. Psalm 30. Psalm 30, verses 5 to 12. Psalm 30, verse 5 says, "For his anger is but for a moment. His favor is for a lifetime." You've experienced God's favor for a lifetime. That's because of the heritage passed on to you. "Weeping may last for the night, but a shout of joy comes in the morning. Now, as for me, I said in my prosperity, I will never be moved. O Lord, by your favor, you've made me a mountain. You made my mountain to stand strong." That's how we get when things are going good. A lot of times. Not everybody. A lot of times. And then it says, "You hid your face, God, and I was dismayed." The house of cards started falling apart. "To you, O God, I called, and to the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my blood if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it declare your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be gracious to me. O Lord, you are my helper. You've turned for me my mourning into dancing, and you've loosed my sackcloth and girded me with gladness." that my soul may sing praise to you and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give thanks to you forever. This is going to happen in your life. And you're going to have some really hard times. You're going to have a lot of ups and downs. But this is going to happen in your life on this side of the grave. And on the other side of the grave, it's going to be amazing. There will be a morning. Joy comes in the morning. There will be a morning. And it takes us back to 1 Thessalonians 4, where we started, verse 13. Paul says, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, and that means physical death, that you may not grieve as those who have no hope, like the rest of the world that doesn't have any hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. So he's comforting the believers about their loved ones that have died. They're going to come back. She's going to come back with the Lord Jesus Christ. For by this we say to you, by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not go before those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Jesus Christ will rise first. That means the physical body and the soul and the spirit will be reunited at this resurrection. Then we who are alive and will remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we will always be with the Lord. And then it says, therefore comfort one another with these words. This is comforting. It's comforting to know that you'll see her again. I hope that it's comforting to know that in the meantime, when you're having to struggle in this body of flesh and struggle with this incredible loss in your life, in the meantime, we pray and hope that you'll be comforted by the presence of God and through your relationship with the Lord. And because that's all we have to offer you, besides our condolences and our presence. You might have come in this afternoon and in your life, you've never come to the place where you're absolutely sure that you're going to heaven. If you died today, you're not sure, absolutely sure that you're going to heaven. You might be thinking, well, I'm pretty good, or I'm hoping I'm good enough. I'm hoping that God will let me in. And a lot of people think that way. If you're good, you go to heaven. If you're bad, you go to hell. And certainly Lisa was good, and so she'll go to heaven. Now, Lisa would tell you, no, that's not the case. That the Bible says every single one of us are sinners, and we've all fallen short of God's perfect standard. But Jesus Christ died on the cross for all of our sins to pay the full penalty of every single one of our sins, and then God offers us the free gift of eternal life. He actually offers us Jesus Christ's own righteousness. If we place our faith in Jesus Christ, that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. There's no way, I'm the way, the truth, and life. No man shall come to the Father except by me. He's not a way or a truth. He's the way and the truth. It's a pretty dogmatic statement, but I guess the one that spoke the universe into existence and knit you together in your mother's womb has every right to make that kind of a statement, because he paid for every single one of your sins on the cross. So that right now, right where you sit, all you have to do, even in the quietness of your heart, is say, oh, yes, I believe that. I believe he paid for my sins. I can't be good enough. I can't be perfect, but I believe he paid for my sins so I could be perfectly forgiven. And God sees your heart and he knows what you're thinking. And if right now, and I'm going to give you an opportunity when we pray, if right now in the quietness of your heart, you tell God, yes, I do believe that. I believe Jesus died for my sins. I believe, God, that you raised him from the dead. And I believe I'm perfectly forgiven. And you can say, thank you for giving me the free gift of everlasting life. Because the scripture says, it's by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. That salvation is a gift of God. You can't earn the gift. We don't deserve it. But when we get that gift and we have that gift, we have the assurance that we're not only a child of God, but we won't go to the lake of fire. We will go to heaven. And to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. And this is amazing assurance that every single person in this room can have. Okay? So I'm going to pray, and I'm going to pray for the family, and I'm also going to give you an opportunity, if you've never placed your faith in Jesus Christ, to do that now, today. This is the day God is calling you to do that. Your heart is beating a little bit faster because you know these things are true, but you've never made this decision, and this is the opportunity for you to make this decision. So if you'll close your eyes and bow your heads, everybody has privacy, nobody's looking around. If you've never come to the place in your life where you know for sure that you have eternal life, right now you can just tell God in the quietness of your heart, yes, God, I do believe that. I know that I'm not good enough. I know I'm a sinner. I believe I'm a sinner. I thank you. You can tell him in the quietness of your heart, thank you for sending your son Jesus to die for my sins. Thank you for raising him from the dead. Thank you for giving me forgiveness of all my sins. Thank you for making me your child forever. And you may be here this afternoon and your heart is breaking for this family. You might be carrying burdens of your own, and you've been dealing with them in some aberrant way. You've not been experiencing peace. And God is calling you into that lonely place. He wants you to be in the wilderness with him in the trial, in the difficulty. But he is there. He is there. In the quietness of your heart, you can tell him, Father, I want to stay in fellowship with you. I want to draw near to you. I want to experience your peace, your comfort, your consolation. Heal my soul. Father, we ask you as a group to give this family mercy in their suffering and in this difficulty, to give them grace, to encourage their spirits. And Lord, with these waves that they experience of dread and grief, we pray that you would give them waves of a blessing and encouragement and grace and love and kindness and healing to their souls. You would make them the men and the women that you desire to make them into. That would be a more pure, more true reflection of the image of the Lord Jesus Christ that you knit together to look just like you. We'll thank you for that. We'll thank Lisa for the example that she gave us, the life that she lived, even the whole that was created because of the love and the refining fire. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, please stand and sing with us.
mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. Cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Be seated.
Actually, I'm sorry. Would y'all stand? Continue to stand. And would you put your hands up toward this family? Toward the family. Father, we're asking for your faithfulness to be manifest in ways that this family could never ask for or dream or imagine. We commit them to you. And we trust you with them. We love you because you are good. We love you because you are love. Increase your love in their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The family invites you to share food with us. And so God bless you. And I know I speak for the family. Thank you for your support. Thank you for being here. So many of you have prayed for them and been with them through this whole trial. And they are a very grateful family. And so, thank you. God bless you. Appreciate you being here.